record. And now enough for me, and let me turn it over to Naomi and Stan. Yours.
Okay, thank you, Bill.
Yep.
Welcome, Stan, and welcome everyone who has joined us. I know we have a very concerned and aware group with us tonight. So I'm hoping we can provoke some ideas and questions and thoughts, and we'll see where we go. I can't start this without asking you, Stan, how you're doing in where you live in California, because you are in the midst of these atmospheric rivers. And so how are you doing there?
We're doing fine, thank you. And thanks everybody for checking in. Lisa, our Stanford alumna in the family, and I live in Davis, California. And you know, it's flat, but it's a little bit higher than the flood zones. And there's not much going on in that regard. It has been an atmospheric river of pretty amazing intensities. Ever since the day before, ever since New Year's Eve, it's been pretty much continuous. And my own rain gauge, I've actually lost track, but it was closing in on 15 inches, which is pretty astonishing. Good start to the year, a little notch out of the drought, which is much appreciated. We need these atmospheric rivers to come by. So we're doing fine and kind of enjoying it.
Good to hear. I'm in Massachusetts, and there was an article in the Boston Globe this evening about how New England is warming. And so New Englanders are losing their swagger because they can't brag about how tough they are in all these cold climes, because, you know, it was 50 degrees here today. So things are changing. In Ministry for the Future takes you for quite a ride. In the book, it takes a really catastrophic event for people to really start doing things. It's that murderous heat wave in India in your book. And we've had a very horrific heat wave in India last year, and we're having this atmospheric river in California right now. Do you think that's enough to motivate people to act, to do something?
Well, yes, but it isn't just one event. There will be no one event that causes everybody to change their mind. That just won't happen. But we're in climate change already. It's undeniable, both statistically and then in almost everybody's lived experience. And so compared to the public attitudes before the pandemic, before I started writing about climate change, which would be, I don't know, 95 or 2004, it depends which book you're talking about. It's already a changed world of heightened awareness and a feeling that it's one of the biggest stories going at all times, that it's not going to end, that it's a polycrisis. It's being named, discussed. The COP meetings are big news, and in between, the disasters are big news. So it's not going to be a kind of a light switch that is on or off. It's more like a rheostat where the heat keeps rising, the attention keeps rising, and the worry, the dread, as Bill described it, keeps rising, and also an intention to do something about it that is much more widespread than I've ever seen before.
Do you think it takes some kind of personal experience with climate change for people to really take notice and not just be reading it in the media. I liken it to the experience of the COVID pandemic, where people, if it hasn't been serious to someone close to you, or you weren't in New York City in the spring of 2020, where the ambulance sirens were running all night, you can kind of put it out of your mind. Like many people can, you know, just keep driving their cars and flying everywhere. And does it take something personal?
I don't think so. The pandemic is a good example of this. At the start of the pandemic, when it was understood that it could kill you if you got it, no matter your age or health condition, people responded quickly, whether or not they had any personal contact with somebody. I'm talking about March of 2020, April 2020. We forget, because it got so messy after that, that the initial response was a kind of public health emergency where people sheltered in place, et cetera. And often without any personal experience, although eventually over the next couple of years, almost everybody has either gotten it or knows somebody who has. And that actually has lessened the feeling of fear and the response. Now, with climate change, well, if you're not killed by something, then you're going to think, well, it's not that bad. But we're very good at generalizing from particulars. And also, this was said to me at COP26 by Zayd Al-Rad Hussein, a Jordanian diplomat who taught me a lot at COP26, who has worked in the UN in the Human Rights Office most of his career. He said, you do not have to be in a plane crash to understand that a plane crash would be bad for you. So I think his point there is that the information that we're getting, news from Pakistan with almost a third of the country underwater, the heat wave in India, which I happen to be in myself, and because it was wet bulb 31 instead of wet bulb 35, it actually wasn't much different than a summer day in Davis. But it was scary if you were going to have to live out in it all the time without air conditioning, for sure. And it lasted more than a month. As everybody knows these stories, the sense that we're in a general crisis, I think, is there, even if you personally haven't been involved in a climate catastrophe. On the other hand, so many people now have. I think the count for the United States that last year, something like 100 million people had their life touched by some kind of climate disaster. So that's getting to be a quarter of the country's population. And so it's going to be everything happening at once, I think, that every year there's going to be $20 billion of damage and many lives lost and lots of dislocations. And that drumbeat is only going to increase. And as the 2020s go on, the knowledge of where we need to be in decarbonization and biosphere protection and where we really are will grow for a while. It's inevitable given the social landscape, where private capital is, where our infrastructures are. And so I think that not only is the heat going to be rising through the 2020s, but the sense of pressure, tension, dread, inadequacy, and maybe also resolve are going to grow, and there will be all kinds of chaotic responses. So one thing I'm suggesting is give up on a pattern of, and understand that it's going to look like chaos for the rest of our lives, but that good things can be happening, and even more good than bad, despite what we hear in the news and over the internet. That, in other words, the mitigations that we're making, the transition to clean energy, these may be more important to the long haul and to dodging a mass extinction event than the drumbeat of disasters that's going to be beating on us.
So you know, it's to, so are you saying we need to get beyond the drumbeat of disasters? Because those can be overwhelming. I mean, the drumbeat of that, those atmospheric rivers right now and those effects, you're not hearing a drumbeat of positive actions that we can take. You're just hearing about the disasters. Do we have to get beyond the hearing about disasters?
No, we have to, what I'm saying is we have to accept that they are going to happen. And atmospheric rivers in California have always been happening. There was a big one in the winter of 1861, 1862 that left the entire Central Valley of California a lake for a couple of months. Everything built in the built infrastructure melted into the lake, and they had to start over. That was an atmospheric river. And there have been, every time we get a La Nina, they used to be called Pineapple Expresses. The phrase atmospheric river is only about 5 or 10 years old, but before that, the phenomena existed. So, and we're going to be seeing a lot of them. And I guess what I'm saying is that that drumbeat of disasters is not the signal that the game is lost, that we're in an apocalypse, and that everything is going to fall apart. It's inevitable. There's always been wild weather. It's going to be wilder. There are going to be climate disasters. On the other hand, let's look at the speed of the clean transition. Let's look at where private capital is being invested. Let's see if the governments of the world at the COPs keep on promising each other to do better, which they're already promised to do, and see if they keep their promises. And there are some positive signs out there that are maybe under the radar, or I've been using the image of a river running into the ocean. There's a lot of crosschop on surface, but you don't know which way the tide is running unless you know where the tide is. Underneath the crosschop, there can be quite a strong current going in a direction you can't quite see by reading the crosschop. And so human history in this next few decades is going to be a wicked battle, and it's going to include lots of climate disasters. It can still be a kind of a best case scenario, given where we are now, that is going to get us squeaking through without a mass extinction event. And so you have to hold to that thought so that you don't simply give up.
I think in a lot of our discussions in our group, people do feel distressed, tired, not knowing what more they can do. It's tough. Are we in a place where commerce is still trumping science and getting in the way of progress?
Yes. But I wouldn't say commerce, because that's just simply trading goods and services that are needed because we are all specialists. I would say capitalism per se, private capital. Capital is invested at the highest rate of return. The highest rate of return is improperly calculated. It's an oversimple algorithm that rewards short-term extraction from the biosphere. It isn't sustainable over the long haul. It creates massive inequality. That's all still in the way. The only way we're going to get through this is to actually both coerce and force private capital to make investments in green projects, and also entice them such that one can still make a living and maybe even make a profit from doing the right thing. Because we are in a capitalist world, there's so much more private capital than there is government reserves. Like the Federal Reserve of the United States has about $4 trillion in reserve. The Federal Bank, the Chinese Central Bank has about $5 trillion. That's the most on earth. Mark Carney at COP26 gathered a group of banks and investors to commit to green investment. He said it added up to $130 trillion. That's a pretty good rough rubric for where power is aligned in this world today when it comes to the power of money, which is the power to hire people to buy stuff and to put people to work. It's an amazing number of human hours. That potential, that capital needs to go to green projects or else we're in terrible trouble. So my novel, for those of you who've read it, this will sound quite familiar, is essentially recommending a kind of return to Keynes. Keynesianism saved us from the Depression and from World War II. It became just active, and then it had an afterlife, the 30 years after World War II, from Bretton Woods on to the Reagan-Thatcher counter-revolution of 1980. And during that time, government stimulus was guiding where business invested by way of regulations, by way of inducements, and really it was just a general structure of feeling, but government controlled to a certain extent. It was a stimulus and a prod in a capitalist economy. That went away in the neoliberal period. And so we're particularly poorly equipped right now to deal with climate change. We have a necessary catastrophe, and it isn't okay to just invest at the highest rate of return when the highest rate of return is a mistake and indeed a kind of a crime. The calculation of it is simply quite wrong and inadequate to our emergency. So we have tools to deal with that legally, legislatively. And so for every individual, your work as a citizen, your work as a in nonprofits, the work that you do in your local level to combat climate change, the various divestment movements in fossil fuels, there's so much that you can do. And really, since I'm talking to Stanford alumni, Stanford is a power spot in the world, a rather enormous power, considering its numbers and its wealth, which are proportionately small, but they have a throw weight. They punch above their weight. And Stanford is a power in the world, and you already all know that because Stanford wants you to know that, and because you can see for yourself in your own lives and careers. So it's possible to organize your efforts and try to do more as an individual, but it also is going to take convincing to get enough people to get a working political majority, which has been squeaky close. And indeed, now we don't even have one, and we just scarcely have had one off and on for the last 20 years, despite the necessity for a working political majority that'll act in the ways that I've described.
I think that one of the resources, I mean, if we're talking to alumni mostly, or to people, in their careers or retired, I think a major resource are young people, because they seem to be much more motivated because this is going to affect more of their lives, and that if we, we tap into that resource and stop just talking to our peers, that could be a resource for us.
Well, I love talking to student groups. I do it quite a lot, and I see their intensity, and they've still got the energy. And as you say, their whole lives are going to be overshadowed by this problem. And so now their life has a meaning. They don't have to struggle to find existential meaning anymore, like maybe kids in the 90s did or the 80s. The meaning is obvious. You got to try to save the world. And so that's a weird blessing. But it is a blessing to have a meaning to your life and your career. And I see it in students all the time. They're going to go at it and do something green, depending on their own abilities and propensities. And you're right. But for those of us who are older, myself included, I'm impressed by Bill McKibben in multiple ways. The thing that he's done recently at 350.org to start an organization called Third Act for people in retirement to organize and hopefully increase the power by holding hands together and becoming a united front, the power of retired people by setting up projects and suggestions and meetings and really a group meetings to increase awareness, knowledge, and also things you can do that are real in the world. He's got a good idea there. And it doesn't have to be Third Act. It can be alumni groups like yours.
I mean, I've done that in my own life, going from being a television producer to a park ranger in Alaska, very much motivated for my concerns about you know, this planet and the living creatures and flora on it. So I do think that the more we mix generations, the better off we'll be. And it's energizing for us old folk to be around all that young motivation and energy. In your book, Ministry for the Future, it took some really, I found it to be kind of a mix of dystopian cynicism and utopian optimism, where, there took some really, I'd say, horrific terrorist or activist events to get things going or moving towards solutions. The crash day, for instance, the Children of Cali murdering murdering the perpetrators of climate change. There have to be better ways, or are we going to face that? Is that where the science fiction is more fiction?
Well, I don't believe in violence, and I don't think it'll help. But I think that if people get angry enough, if the global north doesn't act to combat climate change and to create climate equity by helping the global south through the clean transition, compensating petrostates that are going to go down because they're not burning their oil anymore, not selling it to others, which for some governments will be a catastrophe and bankruptcy instantly. If we don't deal, there's going to be violence. And it won't help. It will probably slow things down even. I wrote the book thinking I need to try to make this future feel realistic. And since I wrote it before the pandemic, we were not quickly responding to climate change in 2019. That was a previous geological era to now, even though it's only 3 years ago, 4 years ago when I wrote it. Well, the violence in my novel is messy and complicated. You never learn what exactly the Ministry for the Future actually did. That I obscured on purpose to put it on the reader. What would you authorize if you were Badim, the guy in charge of the Black Wing? Would it be like tricks from the 1960s Mission Impossible, where you fooled people by theater into good actions? Or would it be flat out murder or an all out subterranean war? You had to decide. I thought it was interesting that Obama recommended the book, which meant, I think, that he read it, because he himself had to make these decisions. He was Badim whilst president, and there were some extrajudicial murders that committed by the U.S. government. And even though governments have a claim as a nation state on a monopoly on violence, nevertheless, it's usually there's a more of a judicial cover, a more of a judicial fig leaf than they had in the Obama years. Maybe that's one of the reasons he liked the book, was that Badim was in there struggling with these issues. But the reader also had to decide, what would I countenance? And also, the book doesn't make a good distinction between murder and sabotage. So say you want to do a civil resistance. You say you finally just want to do something active, that you feel your legislators have been bought by fossil fuel powers, by people who want to drag the world down in some kind of bizarre Götterdämmerung response. Like if I have to change, I'm going to destroy the world. Well, what would you do? Andreas Malm is very good on this in a book called How to Blow Up a Pipeline. He makes the distinction between sabotage and murder. So does Erica Chenoweth, who's now at Harvard's Kennedy School, why civil resistance works. And Bill McKibben is also very good on this, that you need to always stay nonviolent to convince the neutral observers that are, in theory, are out there watching and are going to be persuaded one way or another. Violence is inherently off-putting to that crowd, and so you're tactically wrong to use it. So these are arguments that in the air right now, that Ministry for the Future is just a novel and a data point. You read it, it can make you think. It doesn't have the answers itself. It's a little messy. I might, if I was thinking it over now and writing it now, I might have written a chapter that made a sharp distinction between murder and sabotage to give people more thinking tools about this, but I didn't. And so the book is as messy as history itself is going to be.
Right, right. You also, you know, you offer up solutions. I mean, it's a very kind of in many ways, opaque but optimistic end to the book. And they're economic, and it seems to me like a combination of economic and scientific solutions. And do you think we're on the road to any of those solutions in a meaningful way?
Yes, I do. And I'm quite startled by how far along we are in some of them. I thought the carbon coin, which is the idea of paying people for drawing carbon out of the atmosphere and getting it back into the ground or into living plants, was a speculation, and I had only read one paper about it. It turns out that the central banks have an organization called the Network for Greening the Financial System, and they have a white paper where they've laid out 9 different ways to green money at the monetary level. In the creation of money itself by central banks, they can green it. That startled me. The International Monetary Fund has a thing called special drawing rights. And when you look into that, it's a kind of quantitative easing or giving of money, almost in the form of foreign aid type money, to countries that are in desperate trouble financially and socially. And about $500 billion has been dispersed under these special drawing rights without anybody paying much attention to it or understanding what it was. Carbon quantitative easing is on the table. It's being widely discussed by the relevant authorities. And then at the legislative level, that the IRA bill passed under the Biden administration last year was huge. It wasn't as huge as everybody wanted at first, but it was huger than any other climate bill in history. And everybody I've talked to in climate tech has said it's transformative, that if that bill, the money dispersed out of that bill will get them over the gap from idea to business, from pilot project scaled up to an actual industry. And so the COP 15, the Congress of the Parties meeting in Montreal, where all of the nations on earth agreed to put aside 30% of their land by 2030 for the wild animals. Well, this was simply amazing. If I had written it up, and I did, in ministry, you would say, well, that's science fiction, that's so utopian, we'll never do that. We give no consideration to the wild creatures. And yet here's 30 by 30 as an active program with an international treaty backing it. That might have been the best thing that happened in 2022, where there were quite a few pretty good successes. The loss and damage bank account that was established at COP27, it's an empty bank account right now, but I suspect that the World Bank and the IMF and some nations that maybe are small and prosperous and care will fill that bank balance, and there'll be some money to disperse for loss and damage. And some of that loss might be from countries that say, look, we're not going to burn our oil. We don't want to sell our coal anymore. Colombia, for instance, when Petro and Marquez got elected in Colombia, their platform was land reform, women's rights, and no more selling our coal. And they said, we'll need help with that. Well, that's a loss to them. And so in the loss and damage column, they should be getting paid for a clean transition to get away from their coal and selling their coal, getting to clean energy for themselves. It happened in South Africa. It happened in Indonesia. So these patterns are there. It's not as if the world of policy, diplomats, scientists, academics, and governmental employees of all kinds have not noticed that we're in a desperate crisis. Johan Rockström and others have pointed out we're close to breaking planetary boundaries that will be devastating. And we can't cross those boundaries if we want to pass on a decent biosphere to our generations to come. Well, that's been noticed. This is no longer the same world that I even wrote Ministry for the Future in. I guess I must have written it in 2019. That's right. Finished it right before the pandemic hit, in editing, I made a couple mentions of the 2020 pandemic, a sentence here, a sentence there, but by and large, it's a pre-pandemic novel. And in the 3 years since I wrote it, it's not so much that the world has changed that much, it has, but also I've become aware of things that I wasn't aware of when I wrote the book that are quite hopeful. And I want to say that that book doesn't have any cynicism in it. There's no dystopian cynicism. That's not a word that I would ever agree to apply to my novels. There might be cynical characters occasionally. Mm. That's about as close to villains as I come. There might be snarky, ironic, and angry narrative voices. There are in Ministry. Very often what looks like a Wikipedia article will quickly turn into a rant, but this is not cynicism. This is some kind of hilarious anger.
Okay. I do a little side note. I mean, I have to ask you about the hospice death scene, because and about your writing it, because it, for anyone who has lived through that, you were reliving it in that chapter. I just wonder about why you wrote that scene. It was so powerfully written and so accurate to experience. And it really was the only direct death. I mean, there was death kind of remotely with a couple of characters, but death remotely, but this was so personal and so direct.
Right. I noticed after I wrote the book that there were three prominent deaths, although you're right, that's the only one that you have to read through. The glaciologist, there's a death by accident, there's a death by murder, which is Tatiana, an important minor character, and then Frank, death by illness. So those are kind of the three kind of ways that we go. That wasn't on purpose, but I noticed that they all happened also in the novel after something good had happened. So the novel is trying to keep you from floating away into lands of hope and all will be well. It was partly the reality principle. People do die. People get illnesses before they should, or they get cut off before their 3 score and 10, not to mention 85 or 90. It happens. And I wanted the novel to feel strongly realistic, even though it was coming to a utopian outcome of us getting to a good place. So I also, the novel is a lot about post-traumatic stress disorder. And I began to think about this. We are all post-traumatic, especially this particular group. We're all of a certain age. We have all had trauma. It's part of being human. If you live this long, you will have had trauma. But not everybody gets the stress disorder. And this is interesting, I think, and worth thinking about, because post-traumatic stress disorder is one of the great new affect states of our time. And I don't mean great in terms of good. I mean great in terms of prominence. So how do some people cope with their traumas and go on relatively good mental health, and other people don't? Well, Frank's was particularly bad, his trauma, the village experience that starts the novel, and he doesn't get over it. And we don't hear much about his background to be able to parse why. I don't believe in backstories in novels or in TV shows. This is a silly workshop category, bad narrative technique. You want the readers to be discovering things in their own minds. You want readers inventing backstories that seem right to them, not giving them everything on a platter. So actually, we don't know very much about Frank. We learn when Frank dies that Mary is post-traumatic, that she had a husband who died young of a similar kind of disease. So, but she's gone through it and got to the other side. Sometimes it just takes time, which means really decades, not months, not years, but decades. And other times people find ways of going forward. It was part of the novel, because we are going to be climate traumatized and a lot of people are going to die naturally or prematurely by way of climate disasters, I felt like I had to include it. And of course, you're right. I've been in hospices. I've seen what happens.
Yeah, and it was quite compelling, and I thought a catalyst to move things forward, and I reading it never missed any backstories. You know, you are filling them in as you go, and it's the mystery that keeps you going through it. So I didn't need any backstories. I was very, as Bill mentioned, your next book, which is nonfiction, the High Sierra, a love story. So interested that this book followed Ministry for the Future. How did that happen? How did that evolve?
It's somewhat a coincidence in that with Ministry done, I had finished my contract for 3 novels to give to my wonderful editor at Orbit, Tim Holman. And I therefore had the opportunity to try something else. And with his encouragement, I did. It's also the pandemic hit. It was shelter in place. I had time that I didn't usually have. And I had also been thinking, I want to write about the Sierra Nevadas. I could keel over. And if I was keeling over in some kind of stroke or heart attack and realized I was dying, I would be intensely irritated with myself if I hadn't written this Sierra book. And so everything came together. And I love my editor. He's been the best facilitator and helper and platform and encouragement and advice that one could possibly ask for. And not all artists get their 60s given to them. In fact, mostly they don't.
Right, unfortunately.
Careers are shorter than lifetimes, especially in the arts. You're popular, you're new, people are interested. 25 years later, it's like, well, I was a prominent novelist in the 1990s. Like, why should I even read you now? That happens a lot. And for me, it didn't happen that way, partly because of running into this editor and partly that I still had things to say and a stable home life and everything was set. So I feel quite lucky as a writer. And the Sierra book just, I had been thinking about it on trail for approximately 50 years, had a lot to say, too much to say, had to cut the book back. And the form comes right out of Ministry for the Future. Bunch of chapters, short, various, a miscellany, a little bit of history, a little bit of geology, a little bit of memoir, a little bit of real life adventure, a little bit of backpacking guide, gear talk, bibliography, routes to take. I jumbled it in the same way I had Ministry, which actually made me quite nervous. Because in novels, if you transfer the form of one novel to the next one, you're almost certainly making a mistake. But in this case, it was not a mistake. It gave me a good way to write about all the things that are in this Sierra book. So I just threw it onto the page. And then with the help of my editor's boss, who took over the editing of this because it was a different publisher, but a cousin in the same big company, I got it together quite quickly. And so it's a labor of love. I don't think that I really caught the magic secret of the Sierra Nevada. I think it's uncatchable, but I gave it my best shot and I'm happy that I did it.
Well, I think it's also telling that love story is inspiration for us all to find our own love story. I would just show an example where Professor Lynn Lewis did a survey of the people who watch the bear cameras on explore.org. And what she found was that people who could identify an individual bear were 70% more likely to donate to any conservation cause. And what that said to me was we all have to find our own bear, our own love story and connection to whatever part of this planet. I mean, Oliver Sacks famously talks about even, you know, how a garden can be healing for people. And I think that if we find whatever small love story we can have, it's a catalyst, it's impetus to do something for this planet and for living things.
Oh yeah, I'm sure that's quite true. I'm in total agreement with you, to make it personal, to be embodied, to not just be a theoretical construct like the global has to be, but to be something that you live with your body. I keep a garden. I spend time in the Sierras when I can, but the garden is more daily life and is very enriching. I love seeing wild animals, which happens more in Maine than in California. Sadly, the Central Valley of California, which used to be called the Serengeti of North America, has been depopulated and turned into a factory floor for growing food. It was a mistake, and it's a mistake we can actually rectify. I've been on the hunt for these. This is why I'm so scared of extinction. Almost anything can be restored to health, life being what it is, except for death and extinction. And extinctions, you can't come back from. So if we can avoid extinctions in the next 50 years, that's sort of a low bar for utopia, but it's a profound bar in that if we don't cause a mass extinction event, this century is a success. So it's something that I'm very concerned with, and I love quite a lot the sense of being outdoors. Any of the local projects where you can actually talk about things. Yesterday, I talked at UC Davis about the agricultural history of UC Davis, and I know a lot about that, and some of the students didn't. What a joy to not be talking about the carbon coin, the global level, the Ministry for the Future, the UN, and the atmosphere, and just talking about one institution. Same in my local village, fighting for the existence of a preschool that is endangered. Well, that's extremely specific and small, but it's crucial and satisfying when you get good results out of it. It's something you can sink your teeth into. And I advise everybody to find those as well as the large, more abstract causes.
Yeah, I think it's very important to find those small things. I mean, I think just personally for me, my greatest joy in my work at Katmai is when I hear from children who get inspired by following the lives of the bears and understanding that that small healthy ecosystem. And teachers, it's, you know, you get something back. And I think, you know, in anything that we need to be successful in, we need to get something back. We can't, you know, just keep failing. And doing those small things gives us something more immediate back. And I think in the pandemic, I've found that places that I would go hiking all the time, all of a sudden they were crowded trails because it was where people found relief because they were no longer going to movies and going to restaurants and doing the sort of things that they were used to doing. So it forced them to do other things like go hiking, which was probably the most positive thing that came out of the pandemic. I wanted to ask you, you mentioned in Ministry for the Future knowledge and experience of Indigenous people. And I wonder what kind of influence that has had on you.
Well, thank you for that. I was lucky in a weird way in that I grew up in suburbia in Orange County back in the 50s and 60s, and it could not have been more alienating. A completely white, middle-class, suburban American experience of that time. I was a reader of books and I had lots of mental travels, but I had never really done anything. When my mom sent me out to her aunt's mission to the Navajo Indians. And so there I was near Tuba City in North Arizona near the Utah border at about age, I think 14 or 15, spending about a month with the Navajo and taking some hikes with them to see Rainbow Bridge before there was that lake there, et cetera, et cetera. And actually celebrating the 4th of July, which is a weird thing to celebrate with Native Americans, as I realized at the time. But what struck me so strongly then was the world is real. It's not just the books that I loved. It was amazing. And I never really got over it. I did some incredibly stupid things, and the Navajo who was sort of in charge of me just let me do stupid things rather than telling me not to. So it was learning by experience, and luckily I didn't kill myself. It changed a lot. Now, in the current situation, I think we're a lot of good is happening with Indigenous people in terms of reparations, returning land, and in returning control of land. Pretty great in California, elsewhere in the world, I'm not so sure, but it's easy to focus on California as being a kind of a leader in so many different ways. And what I want to say, though, is that it's the Indigenous system of ethics and religion that the world is sacred, that the biosphere takes care of us, like a parent, that this is the crucial insight out of Indigenous practices, that their technical traditions, their lifeway traditions were shattered in the 19th and 20th centuries. And a lot of their science was Paleolithic science, really good as far as it went. But now in the situation that we're in, the actual scientific community, which includes Indigenous scientists, of course, but has gone so far and done so much that we can learn Indigenous practices, but you don't want to go into some kind of a noble savage rhapsody, which is just as wrong as denigrating Native Americans. They don't have the cure to climate change because they were never involved with the fossil fuel burns. They can teach you about their individual landscapes that they know, but they themselves are alienated from it. I saw this in the Navajo Reservation by white people, by pickup trucks, by coal plants, by alcohol, and by guns. So the thing to valorize is living Indigenous people's political rights in a kind of reparative way, and then also their spiritual attitude, that we can learn from that big time. It's the world is not a machine, it's not an instrument, it's not something, it's not ours. This is what they can teach us.
So what's next? What's next for you?
Man, I don't know.
That's a good answer. I like that.
Truthfully, the Ministry for the Future is still occupying my entire life. It's blown up my life in a way that is entirely good. But I will say the shift from novelist to public intellectual is uncomfortable for me. A public intellectual is way too close to an op-ed writer, and I don't like op-eds. So I'm struggling to figure out how to be useful when it's really my book that was useful and might still be useful. And I can do little more than but maybe I can do some things. So I'm trying to figure that out. And in the meantime, I have some writing ideas, and I'll get to them as soon as I can.
Yeah, maybe we should stop inviting you to speak so that you can get back to writing.
No, I don't have any stories that are burning, or else I would tell them. I don't want to do sequels to Ministry for the Future. I've got some other ideas. I'll get to them. A friend of mine, I was kind of moaning, oh God, I'm so busy, which is a stupid thing. It's a kind of backwards form of bragging. And he said, Stan, you're doing the Lord's work. Just shut up and do it. So I've been trying to learn from that, and trying to figure out what can you say to people that might be helpful? Or can you network people who really know things who should know each other? Because this world is so big, people who should know each other, whoa, they don't. And you can introduce them, and very fruitful collaborations can begin between people who got introduced by you. And that's kind of beautiful. That has happened, and I hope to do it more.
Yes, I love that notion. I really do. So speaking of making connections, let's open this up to questions. Let's get Bill and Janine back and see what questions we have for you.
All right. Well, this has been a really fascinating discussion, and I hope that people will appreciate it. One of the things that I really got from this, which was a continuation of the last one, which has to do with telling the stories. Now, I'm a biologist, scientist, so the details are what I'm familiar with, but it seems now it's a matter of having the right people tell the right stories to make those connections, to get people to understand where their special spot is, where they want to protect. Now, one of the questions that we had relates to that, and it was, there are many writers on this Zoom. Where could we direct our best efforts in support of climate action? Are there voids not being filled?
There's one void that isn't being filled I can think of immediately. But first, I should say, follow your inner writer and do what they say. A lot of times, it's not a matter of conscious choice. It's what the invisible and not well connected to you little writer inside you tells you to write. That's the way it is for me. But what we don't have is a good measurement that would replace rate of return. In other words, an economic rubric, an index that said, you do these things, you will be doing good, and you will make more money than you spent to do them. Concocting that system, that political economy, I've been hunting for 35 years for economists that would lay that out for me. It's kind of not out there. Economists in our world and economics departments take the axioms of capitalism for granted and go from there. They are theorems without axioms. They are quantified ethical systems without looking into the fundamentals of their ethical system. And therefore, if you want a better system, it's still waiting to be made up. And right now it's a kludge. In my novels, I go to Mondragon, I go to ideas out of eco-socialism, I go to Thomas Piketty and progressive taxation and his crowd. I think about cooperative movements and all this, but this is an amalgam of differing ways to improve, reform, or even sometimes replace neoliberal capitalism. Nothing comprehensive and persuasive has been written up yet that the legislatures and the central banks that you could take to a staffer at Congress and say, look, this is a legislative program. And there are some think tanks that work on this. The Roosevelt Institute is a good one. And there are many more, but somehow we still don't have it, in my opinion. And now I want to say this, things are changing so fast that somebody will say, well, but what about Kate Raworth and donut economics? Yes, great example. What about Herman Daly, who just died, with his steady state economics? Yes, great example. But there's room for more, there's room for improvement. And I wonder if anybody has, in writing it up coherently, which I've sometimes thought of myself, but I don't have the competencies, writing that up coherently might be persuasive and powerful, might make a difference in policies and in laws.
So one of the questions was more of a statement, but humanity is obviously on the wrong path, i.e. fossil fuel suicide. What would you recommend world leaders do if you had the chance to provide them with a roadmap? What would your plan for getting us off this path and do a better one? Which actually is what you kind of was just you were just talking about.
Yeah, an economic plan. Well, you would need, the G2, the US and China, if they agreed that it was crucial to get a handle on this, those are the two big dogs. And then the EU, if those three were to agree as world leaders, and there's a lot of goodwill in all three of those countries to attack the climate problem because it's existential and everybody's going to be crushed by it. Then the G20, then also the Paris Agreement is the mechanism for this. That's 190 countries. There's only a couple countries that haven't signed off on it. And the world leaders are attentive to that. Live up to your Paris Agreement commitments. And that could be the mechanism where we squeak through this one. That's what I would say to world leaders. And a lot of them, this happens in this world. A lot of them would say yes out of one side of their mouth. And then they have very powerful forces saying no. And within their own governments, they would have competing forces fighting each other. So diplomats will come back from COP26, from COP27 and say, oh, we promised this. And there'll be people in that very same government saying, we're not going to do that. That would crash our economy. So the need for an understanding of economics that is pro-biosphere, that sets the axiom as this: health of the biosphere and equality and health of peoples, those are what the equation we're solving for. And economics has to solve for that, not for private capital, and not for shareholder value, not for quarterly profit, but for these other goals. And the economics for that is still a work in progress.
And to follow up, because we are Stanford alumni for the most part, and we are watching the evolution of the new school, the Dorr School of Sustainability.
Yeah.
It's cross-disciplinary. It's to mix a lot of different people that often don't talk to each other and don't work together to have a speed and scale, to use John Doerr's book title. Do you think that there is that mix will achieve the necessary changes? Because now the people in the business school are talking to the people that are in the environmental field and trying to get their love, and I mean the love of their space, into action. What do you think?
I think we need it. It's the right attempt right now. We can't invent and institute an entirely new political economy across the earth in a timely fashion. We can't do that fast enough because a lot of people won't agree to the notion that we have to. And we are where we are. So you got to look at the tools that we have, and they're super awkward. The nation state system, international neoliberal capitalism, which includes all the trade laws, the WTO, the various mechanisms, and then academia with its disciplinary divisions, its siloing, its competition for resources, its incomprehensibility to each other's in terms of departments. It's a mess. It's not a good solve the problem structure that we're working with, but it's all we've got. So you got to look to where you can fix that. And an institute like the Dorr Institute will be trying to put people together, trying to spark ideas and make partnerships. And if they will only, I worked with Stanford's CASBIS, Center for Applied Behavioral Sciences, for a project called Inventing a New Moral Political Economy. I thought adding the word moral was a mistake. It should be inventing a new political economy, to keep it simple, and to try to keep ethics out of it and keep it focused on economy, political economy. That was already the subject, and they muddied the waters and they never got very far, but it was the right kind of an effort. And I think the Dorr School will have more resources. They'll continue that effort. They'll have some of those same people working on it. That'll be happening in many institutions. And one of the things that I think is going to be happening pretty soon is we've got now thousands of good climate efforts. They don't know about each other well enough. It's hard to rate which are most effective. It's hard to coordinate their actions with each other. So I hear that the UN is going to start trying to help with this, and it would be congruent with the Paris Agreement, a summit of the future. And so I think actually my book and its title were provocative to people at the UN. And so the Secretary General will start running a summit of the future. Plans are that it will be attempting to combine all these different forces, business, government, nonprofits, and general populations, and universities, academia, in a grand confluence to discuss what are the most important things. I think they'll be modeling their SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, and there was quite considerable success with the SDGs being implemented to fight poverty in the world. It wasn't a total success, but it was, considering it was done on the margins, in other words, done out of a set of gifts rather than as a way of doing business. If we can entrain business to join that and actually have people making their living at it rather than giving their time to it as volunteers, making their livings and their careers at it, you could imagine a coherent effort here, like turning incoherent light into a laser beam, much more effective for certain purposes. I mean, you'd rather look at incoherent light, but if you're going to try to burn something or do something, then you need a laser beam. And so this is just an analogy, but you see what I mean. This is one of the main things that your new DOR Institute will be helping with.
And that's the hope. That's it. Now I have to do something that is, I like provoking or instigating or getting these kind of discussions going. And I always get at the end going, I got to stop, cut off the discussions. And it's 7:03. But would you, either of you, or both of you, try to give sort of your closing thoughts to have the people remember most?
Naomi?
Gosh, I just think that what a gift to have a provocative book and a provocative mind, and that should spur us onward. I mean, we've been in our group trying to figure out how to move, how to have progress personally and as a group, and I think that I'm very grateful for Stan joining us tonight and stimulating a lot of thought.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you, Naomi, for that and for your questions. I really enjoyed the conversation. And I just going to say what I've said before. Stanford is a world power beyond its size and even its wealth. It's more powerful than that because of its intellectual heft. It's a combination of brain power, generosity, and wealth that, although it has been very enthusiastic participant in the capitalist economy and made its way very well as a company and a spawner of companies, it also transcends that because the university is a pre-capitalist and hopefully post-capitalist institution, and Stanford's one of the most powerful on earth. So you have a chance to leverage, as they would say in the economics classes. You can leverage your powers. And boy, leverage. I've been moving boulders that haven't moved in 10,000 years with an iron bar. And it's like Archimedes said, if you can find a place to put the lever and move it, then you can move immense weights. And I think that's what you are hunting for there. Is that point to put the lever in and to exert the leverage. So good luck to you. And I know for a fact I'll be visiting, seeing some of you in person, seeing some of you on Zoom, seeing some of you in classrooms at Stanford. I'm frequently there. I like it a lot. It's an inspirational place. So as a UC graduate, I say, you know, go Stanford. The Stanford tree is a great, was that what they call it? The Stanford robber barons, the Stanford tree.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know that story. You probably do. The Stanford Cardinal. Well, that's not so good, but what the hell? A bird. You know, fly.
A color. Yeah.
A color. Yeah. Bloody.
All right.
Get bloody. Definitely. In the good fight. And I look forward to, in order to focus, I haven't looked at the chats. I see there are 52. I'm quite interested. If you can send those along, I'll answer them if you want, or I'll just read them.
Yep. Well, I've captured all of them. They will be, I've captured many of them in a Word document, but I'll have to go and finish the rest of them. I will pass it along, and I will happy to then pass that around to the people that I will then send a link to for the talk. So we'll keep making sure that more people get to appreciate the discussions and the inspiration. I say inspiration because what you were talking about, how the DOR School and Stanford in general can be an outside influence, outsized compared to the number of people at all. And that's the motivation to try to pull SACA together and get more people involved, a broader demographic involved, so that we can make a difference. So yeah. I and many other people on the call say very much thank you for your time. And I think we'll continue this conversation.
Righto. I'll see you all again, I'm quite sure, one way or another.
Absolutely.
So thank you.
Great. Thanks, Dan. Thanks, yep. Naomi. Bye.
Night-night. Yep.